Blood, Sweat and Pixels is written by Jason Schreier, a journalist who spent 9 years of their life writing game news for a video game website named Kotaku. Unlike many popular stories about making your first game and all of a sudden becoming a millionaire, this book focuses on the bad aspects of game development that nobody likes to talk about. It doesn't have unicorns, magic or pink goggles, and instead it tells about working with impossible to meet deadlines or budgets, overworking, burnouts, massive layoffs, and throwing away years of your work. If something like that managed to get a great on Kindle label and 4.7 stars out of more than 1000 ratings, then you can be certain that something is wrong with this industry. And obviously that this book is brilliant. If this book had only one example, nobody would be convinced. So instead, you learn about the teams behind some of the best-selling and most popular games. 10 of them, in fact. I'll just list a few questions, and in case they spark your imagination, make sure to read Blood, Sweat and Pixels. There is no way it can possibly disappoint you. How many years of hard work did it take a person who couldn't get a job in game dev to make Stardew Valley? And what did it take to make such a masterpiece without a team of developers or any budget whatsoever? How do Diablo 3 and Blizzard games in general go from disastrous launches to games everyone loves? Should you keep sequels true to the original games, or maybe tweaking and changing even the core mechanics isn't always a bad idea? Speaking of which, do you think a real-time strategy game can ever work on consoles? Well, I'm not competent enough to answer that question, but luckily, the devs of Age of Empires and later Halo Wars have got you covered. Oh, and by the way, before it became Halo Wars, this game was known as Phoenix, which had its own characters and lore about Earthlings fighting Martians. The devs spent over a year building this universe, so who could possibly throw all of that work away to turn the project into something completely different? From the same devs, you'll also find out that making false promises on E3 isn't always the devs' fault. But at the same time, you might be shocked to find out how much of the stuff shown at such conferences is totally fake and doesn't have anything to do with the real gameplay. Since we're talking about E3, how do you make a sequel to a massive RPG such as Dragon Age in less than 16 months? The answer is, you don't. And that's why the recycled locations of Dragon Age 2 weren't warmly welcomed by fans, even though merely finishing something under such constraints was a great accomplishment for the devs. Next, how do you fix 99,000 bugs in a game while working on a new engine that was made for a completely different genre of games and didn't have proper development tools until years later? You have no idea? Well, I can't imagine that either, but apparently that's how Dragon Age Inquisition was made on Frostbite. I could keep talking about the bizarre questions Blood, Sweat and Pixels answers for hours, but I believe that it's better for you to spend this time actually reading this book instead. You'll certainly love exploring the topics of bugs that happen when you dismount a horse in a specific place. What happens when you run out of money on both your debit and credit cards? How people wish they hadn't promised so much on their Kickstarter campaign? How can someone make the third game in the life of their company bigger and less repetitive than Skyrim? Why are projects always delayed? Or how you can spend years working on a game that everyone loves and then have to change it into something else and finally see how your entire team gets laid off and the project cancelled? Ah, damn it, I said I'd stop, but I can't, this book is just too exciting. You owe yourself to read Blood, Sweat and Pixels if these titles are more than a name to you. Pillars of Eternity, Halo Wars, Stardew Valley, Uncharted 4, Diablo 3, Dragon Age Inquisition, Shovel Knight, Destiny, The Witcher 3, or Star Wars 1313. Get your hands on it in any way possible. Or if you decide to purchase this book and support these reviews at the same time, please use my paid link from the description below this video. By the way, a Kindle version of this book has a very nice feature I personally haven't seen before. Footnotes. These extra bits of information were exciting to read and often gave me a different perspective on what was said in the book. Alright, have a nice day and I'll see you in the next book review. Farewell.